So now's the time to introduce our speaker. I'm glad the microphone's working now, Alex. Alex Filippenko is professor of astronomy at UC Berkeley. Actually, his proper title is the Richard and Rhoda Goodman Professor, Distinguished Professor in the Physical Sciences. He earned his PhD in astronomy at Caltech in 1984. He is one of Earth's most highly cited astronomers, with over 700 research papers in print. Alex Filippenko was co-discoverer of the accelerating expansion of the universe, a phenomenon explained nowadays by the exquisitely vague term dark energy. That discovery, and therefore by inference, Alex himself, was the focus of the 2011 Nobel Prize in Physics. Alex has won many awards for his research in his life, and he has been voted best professor at UC Berkeley a record 9 times. This man can teach. And yet, the pinnacle of his career, the zenith, the acme, was his decision to join the Wonderfest Board of Directors just a couple months ago.
Cosmic ocean. On this shore, we've learned most of what we know. Recently, we've waded a little way out, maybe ankle deep, and the water seems inviting. Some part of our being knows this is where we came from. We long to return. And we can't, because the cosmos is also within us. We're made of star stuff. We are a way for the cosmos to know itself. The journey for each of us begins here. We're going to explore the cosmos in a ship of the imagination, unfettered by ordinary limits on speed and size, drawn by the music of cosmic harmonies. It can take us anywhere in space and time. Perfect as a snowflake, organic as a dandelion seed, it will carry us to worlds of dreams and worlds of facts. Come with me.
Please welcome Alex Filippenko.
Great, thank you very much, Tucker. And it's wonderful to see all of you here. Our plan is to go through these various segments of the cosmos, and then I'll say a few things about them. I actually have not seen them for many, many years. And then you can ask questions on these topics, and maybe at the very end there will be questions on a broader range of topics. It turns out that there's a new version of the cosmos coming out, not in 2013 as had originally been planned, but in 2014. And the host will be Neil deGrasse Tyson. I, as far as I know, have nothing to do with the series, and I have no inside information, nor did I have any inside information on the cosmos. So if you want me to tell you what Carl was doing behind the scenes and all that, I have no idea. And similarly, I have really no idea what's going on for the new one. But Tucker asked me to do this, and I think it's a great chance to go through parts of the series, which really was very influential. A lot of people saw it. A lot of people got interested in science and astronomy as a result of that. Of it, and I hope the same thing will happen in the remake in a year and a half or so. So thank you all for coming. And I don't know, should we talk about the first scene there, Tucker, where he was on the shores of the cosmic ocean? I'll say a few words about it, I guess. First, he has an interesting way of speaking, despite the inspirational aspects of the show and all that. Many of his colleagues found him to be quite arrogant and difficult to deal with on a personal level, actually. He really did think very, very highly of himself. Anyway, but anyway, so that inside information I do have. I mean, I did know Carl, and I was very saddened by his death from cancer. In, I believe it was 1994, something like that. Yeah, it was quite some time ago now. But anyway, it was a wonderful series. So he said that we're in ankle deep and the water seems inviting. And indeed, it's been an amazing 32 years since then. I mean, there's really a lot to update. And I don't know that we'll get into it. Maybe we will, but you know, we now think that atoms consist only 4% of the total matter plus energy content of the universe, okay? So averaged over big enough distances, say spheres a billion light years in diameter, okay, these are really big spheres, all right? The typical stuff is not atoms, unlike the case here on Earth and in this room. The typical stuff is dark matter, which is 23% of the contents of the universe, and even stranger still, dark energy, which is 73% of the contents. So 96% of the contents of the universe was not even hinted at, I believe, in this series. Maybe the dark matter was to some degree. I don't remember, Tucker, whether Carl Sagan discussed the rotation of galaxies and how stars are bound inside galaxies, but they're moving around so quickly that you can calculate how much gravity is needed to keep them there. And it's more gravity than can be attributed to the visible stars that are there. So I actually don't remember whether that was mentioned. But if it was, I think it was probably only briefly. And the full impact of this situation with galaxies probably wasn't quite super well appreciated in 1980. So, I mean, you know, if you were around right now to hear that we only knew about sort of 1/25th of the universe back then, he would be very surprised. And so that's a huge area in which growth has occurred. The other big area, which is in the limelight a lot these days, is exoplanets or extrasolar planets, planets orbiting other stars. Now, I do recall that he speculated on this possibility in the show, and now we have really tremendous amounts of data showing that planetary systems are really quite common. The Kepler mission has been finding lots and lots of candidates, over 2,300 of them in the first year and a half of its operation, more than 90% of which are likely to be true exoplanets. So what was speculation back in 1980, though reasonable speculation based on our understanding of how our own solar system formed, it seemed reasonable that there are solar systems or planetary systems elsewhere. We now have definitive proof of these other planetary systems, and now the goal is to find Earth-like planets, and we're getting very, very, very close. I mean, there are now planets, exoplanets known having roughly the mass of the Earth, and within the range of distances from a star such that liquid water might be possible on the surface. So that's a great frontier. The study of black holes has gone through great strides, and many, many other things. So I'm hoping that there will be a representative sample of clips here that we'll be able to talk about and explore. And then, as I said at the end, we can explore any other topics that might have been missing from these clips, but which have really been an important part of astrophysics in the past three decades. Okay, sound good?
One collective enterprise of science has revealed a universe some 15 billion years old, the time since the explosive birth of the cosmos, the Big Bang. The cosmic calendar compresses the local history of the universe into a single year. If the universe began on January 1st, it was not until May that the Milky Way formed. Other planetary systems may have appeared in June, July, and August, but our Sun and Earth not until mid-September. Life arose soon after. Everything humans have ever done occurred in that bright speck at the lower right of the cosmic calendar. The Big Bang is at upper left in the first second of January 1st. 15 billion years later is our present time, the last second of December 31st.
Every month is 1.25 billion years long. Each day represents 40 million years. Each second stands for some 500 years of our history, the blinking of an eye in the drama of cosmic time. At this scale, the cosmic calendar is the size of a football field, but all of human history would occupy an area the size of my hand. We're just beginning to trace the long and tortuous path which began with the primeval fireball and led to the condensation of matter, gas, dust, stars, galaxies, and at least in our little nook of the universe, planets and life, intelligence and inquisitive men and women. We've emerged so recently that the familiar events of our recorded history occupy only the last seconds of the last minute of December 31st. Some critical events for the human species, however, began much earlier, minutes earlier.
So we change our scale from months to minutes. Down here, the first humans made their debut around 10:30 p.m. on December 31st. And with the passing of every cosmic minute, each minute 30,000 years long, we began the arduous journey towards understanding where we live and who we are.
11:46. Only 14 minutes ago, humans have tamed fire. 11:59:20. The evening of the last day of the cosmic year, the 11th hour, the 59th minute, the 20th second. The domestication of plants and animals begins. An application of the human talent for making tools. '11:59:35. Settled agricultural communities evolve into the first cities. We humans appear on the cosmic calendar so recently that our recorded history occupies only the last few seconds of the last minute of December 31st. In the vast ocean of time which this calendar represents, all our memories are confined to this small square. Every person we've ever heard of lived somewhere in there. All those kings and battles, migrations and inventions, wars and loves, everything in the history books happens here in the last 10 seconds of the cosmic calendar.
We on Earth have just awakened to the great oceans of space and time from which we have emerged. We are the legacy of 15 billion years of cosmic evolution. We have a choice. We can enhance life and come to know the universe that made us, or we can squander our 15 billion year heritage in meaningless self-destruction. What happens in the first second of the next cosmic year depends on what we do here and now with our intelligence and our knowledge of the cosmos.
Well, that was certainly very interesting. He used an age of 15 billion years. It turns out that's pretty good. We now know that the universe is 13.7 billion years old, so that wasn't that far off. But we're now much, much more secure about that number. Back in 1980, the number he gave was really uncertain, I would say to at least plus or minus 50%. In other words, it could have been 8 billion years old and it could have been 21 or 22. The uncertainties were really that big. And now the uncertainty is only 100 or 200 million years, so 0.1 or 0.2 giga year out of the 13.7. So he didn't really, at least in this part, he didn't discuss the uncertainty in that value which was, you know, 50% or at least 30%. It could easily have gone from, say, 10 billion to 20 billion years. And in the more extreme scenarios, 8 to 22. But the number he chose fortuitously was roughly right. So the cosmic calendar that he showed remains largely unchanged, except in detail. So he said that 1 month corresponds to 1.25 billion years. Now with this revised age of the universe, 1 month corresponds to 1.75 billion years. So instead of 1.25 billion years, a cosmic month now is 1.75. And so aside from small details, the numbers he gave there as to when various things appeared, life in May and all that kind of stuff, those are broadly speaking still correct. But we have much, much greater certainty. The reason we now have greater certainty is that two key factors have advanced tremendously since 1980. The first is that we know the current expansion rate of the universe quite well now, and it was poorly known back then. For those who may have done some reading about this, the whole issue is this thing called the Hubble constant. The speed of galaxies is proportional to their current distance, V equals H naught D, and H naught is the so-called Hubble constant. In weird units, kilometers per second per megaparsec, where a megaparsec is like 3.25 million light years. Don't worry about where that comes from. But in these weird units, back in 1980, the numbers that were being thrown around were between 50 kilometers per second per megaparsec and 100 kilometers per second per megaparsec. And so we didn't know the expansion rate of the universe to better than a factor of 2. And we now know it. It's 71 plus or minus 3 kilometers per second per megaparsec. That's an amazing improvement in the precision with which we know the result. We also know that the universe hasn't been expanding at a constant rate. So, you know, I can take this apple here and I can throw it, okay, and gravity of the Earth slows it down. If the Earth were less massive, then the apple would travel a greater distance in a given amount of time because it wouldn't be slowing down as much. If the Earth were not present, then the apple wouldn't slow down at all if you ignore all other things like the Sun and Jupiter. He had to assume some rate of change of the expansion rate, and he probably assumed that it wasn't changing very much at all. To get numbers of order 15 billion back in 1980 when the Hubble constant wasn't known very well, he would have had to assume, you know, some amount of deceleration, but not much, is my guess. Now we know from the amounts of visible matter and dark matter and this repulsive dark energy, which is currently accelerating the expansion of the universe, we know the mixture of various gravitational and anti-gravitational, so to speak, these dark energy effects. So we know the expansion history of the universe. So we know the current expansion rate and we know the expansion history pretty well. We don't have to make assumptions about the deceleration rate. Indeed, in the past 5 billion years, the universe has been accelerating, the big surprise that was honored with last year's Nobel Prize in Physics. So knowing the current expansion rate and the history of the expansion, we can calculate pretty accurately the age since the Big Bang. And that's the thing that's 13.7 or 13.75 plus or minus 0.1 or so. So that's very accurately known now. The other thing that struck me, before I get to the other thing, let me also give you a different cosmic calendar that I like to use in my introductory class. Instead of making 13.7 billion years equal to one Earth year, I like to squeeze it down to one Earth day, which is 86,400 seconds. In a model where the age of the universe is squished down to one day, okay, roughly 100,000 seconds, Homo sapiens appeared about 1 second ago. All right, now Homo sapiens appeared roughly 180,000 years ago, and if you scale things down, that turns out to be 1 second ago in the cosmic day, okay? A nice long human lifetime, 100 years for round numbers, is 6/10,000ths of a second. Okay, so your lifetime is much shorter than that what's this called?
Snap.
I had a rough day. I was playing tennis this morning and I overextended my leg and I pulled a muscle or something. So anyway, a snap of the fingers is longer than your lifetime when you squish the age of the universe down to one day. That's kind of cool. He mentioned that the Big Bang was a gigantic explosion. And we now more fully understand, although this was the case even in his day, he probably just tried to simplify it, which is understandable. But we now know that using the word explosion is somewhat misleading. Because people ask, well, where was the center of the universe? Where did the Big Bang originate if it was an explosion? All explosions that you're used to, like firecrackers or bombs or whatever, have a center. All the shrapnel goes flying out, okay? And so an explosion suggests a center. But in fact, the universe is known to be expanding, and the Big Bang theory simply says that long ago, roughly 14 billion years ago, it was in a hot and compressed state that began to expand for some reason, and it's been expanding and cooling and becoming less dense ever since. But there is no center, at least not in dimensions to which we have any physical access. You can't point to that place over there and say that's the center. You all were the center in a sense. There is no unique center. And the better way to think about it is to consider perhaps the expansion of a balloon, where this is my hypothetical universe. It's expanding, not too much, otherwise I'll get a little bang. And let's say the laws of physics are constrained to operate only on the surface of the balloon, or more precisely, within the rubber itself. So you can go forwards and backwards, left and right, or any combination of those two motions. But you can't go into the balloon or out of the balloon. That's a mathematical dimension. I mean, we can imagine it from our perspective here, that even the creatures on this balloon could imagine, but they couldn't physically go there or point to it. So in this case, if you have stickers, and I forgot to bring my stickers, you could see all the stickers moving away from all the others. And each sticker would think it's the center of expansion because it would see all others moving away from it. So it would say, yay, I'm great, I'm the center of expansion. But it would call up its buddies, and its buddies on the other stickers would say, well, all the galaxies are moving away from us too, so we must be the center. And they'd all be fighting about who's the center. None of them is the unique center. Okay, the Big Bang, the expansion is happening everywhere. It's not an explosion of the universe within our three-dimensional space. It's the expansion of our three-dimensional space within some, you might call it, mathematical hyperspace. Whether a fourth dimension really does exist or not, we don't know. Just like in this balloon's case, it's expanding into the third dimension, into a radial dimension, which they can't point to, but they can mathematically describe it. And it may have a reality. In this case, in our case, looking at this balloon, it clearly does. We're out here. But in their, from their perspective, it's not even clear that that other dimension has a physical reality. It has a mathematical reality, but it doesn't necessarily have a physical reality, and they certainly can't point to it or send, you know, apples into it. Okay? They're expanding into it, but they're not part of it. And the center of this expansion is the center of the balloon. But is that part of this universe, this hypothetical universe, as I've defined it? No, the center of the balloon is not part of the universe. It's in that radial dimension, which they can mathematically describe, but they can't physically go to it. So this expanding balloon is like a Big Bang, an expanding universe, but it has no unique center. And it's not like something exploded and is expanding within this balloon. The whole balloon is expanding, you know, into another dimension. Or if it's infinite in size, it's not even clearly expanding into another dimension. But in any case, the Big Bang shouldn't be thought of as an explosion within our three-dimensional space. Rather, it's an expansion of our three-dimensional space. Okay.
In remote central Siberia, there was a time when the Tungus people told strange tales of a giant fireball that split the sky and shook the earth. They told of a blast of searing wind that knocked down people and whole forests. It happened, they said, on a summer's morning in the year 1908. In the late 1920s, L.A. Kulik, a Soviet scientist, organized expeditions to try and solve the mystery. He built boats to penetrate this trackless land, snowbound in winter, a swampy morass in summer. Eyewitnesses told of a ball of flame larger than the sun that had blazed across the sky 20 years before. Kulik assumed a giant meteorite had struck the Earth. He expected to find an enormous impact crater and rare meteorite fragments chipped off some distant asteroid. However, at ground zero, Kulik found upright trees stripped of their branches, but not a trace of the meteorite or its impact crater. He was deeply puzzled, but he thought perhaps there were meteorite fragments buried in the swampy ground. So he set about digging trenches and pumping out the water, but the expected meteoritic rock and iron was nowhere to be found. Undaunted, Kulik went on to make a thorough survey, despite the swarms of insects and other hardships, because he had discovered something that, in his own words, exceeded all the tales of the eyewitnesses and my wildest expectations. For more than 20 kilometers in every direction from ground zero, the trees were flattened radially outward like broken matchsticks. There must have been a powerful explosion several kilometers above the ground. The pressure waves spreading out at the speed of sound has been reconstructed from barometric records at weather stations across Siberia, through Russia, and on into Western Europe. Dust from the explosion reflected so much sunlight back to Earth that people could read by it at night in London, 10,000 kilometers away. This really remarkable occurrence is called the Tunguska event. But what was it? Well, perhaps, some scientists have suggested, it was a chunk of antimatter from space, annihilated on contact with the ordinary matter of the Earth, disappearing in a flash of gamma rays. But the radioactivity that you'd expect from matter-antimatter annihilation is to be found nowhere at the impact site. Or, perhaps, other scientists have suggested, it was a mini black hole from space which impacted the Earth in Siberia, tunneled its way through the solid body of our planet, and plunged out the other side. But the records of atmospheric shockwaves give not a hint of something booming out of the North Atlantic later that day. Or maybe, other people have speculated, it was a spaceship of some unimaginably advanced extraterrestrial civilization in desperate mechanical trouble crashing in a remote region of an obscure planet. Well, if so, it's pretty startling that at the impact site there's not a piece, not the tiniest transistor of a crashed spacecraft. More prosaically, perhaps it was a large meteorite or small asteroid which hit the Earth. But even here, there are no observable telltale rocky or metallic fragments of the sort that you'd expect from such an impact. The key point of the Tunguska event is that there was a tremendous explosion, a great shock wave, many trees burned, an enormous forest fire, and yet no crater in the ground. There seems to be only one explanation which is consistent with all these facts. And that explanation is this. In 1908, a piece of a comet hit the Earth. No one saw it approach, a small point of light lost in the glare of the morning sun. It had been drifting for centuries through the inner solar system, like an iceberg in the ocean of interplanetary space. But this time, by accident, there was a planet in the way. From the time and direction of its approach, the object that hit the Earth seems to have been a fragment of a comet named NK, hurtling at more than 100,000 kilometers an hour. It was a mountain of ice about the size of a football field and weighing almost a million tons. There was no warning until it plunged into the atmosphere. If such an explosion happened today, it might be thought, especially in the panic of the moment, to be produced by a nuclear weapon. Such a cometary impact and fireball simulates all the effects of a 15 megaton nuclear burst, including the mushroom cloud, with one exception: there would be no radiation. So, could a rare but natural event, the impact of a comet with the Earth, trigger a nuclear war? It's a strange scenario. A small comet hits the Earth, as millions of them have during the history of our planet, and the response of our civilization is promptly to self-destruct. Maybe it's unlikely, but it might be a good idea to understand comets and collisions and catastrophes a little bit better than we do. Now, a comet, at least as far as we understand them today, is made mostly of ice. Water ice, maybe some ammonia ice, a little bit of methane ice. So, in striking the Earth's atmosphere, a modest cometary fragment will produce a great radiant fireball and a mighty blast wave. It'll burn trees and level forests and make a sound heard around the world, but it need not make a crater in the ground. Why? Because the ices in the comet are all melted in the impact, and there's going to be very few recognizable pieces of comet left on the ground.
Okay, so that's a very interesting topic, and he was pretty much right on in terms of what it might be. It's not, you know, antimatter or a black hole or anything like that. I think most people studying the event think it's a comet. It's still a little bit puzzling, though, that no remains have been seen, because a comet is not entirely ice. It's got, you know, little rocks and things in it, and so it's a bit weird that none of these meteorites associated with the comet have been found. Some still think it might have been some kind of a loosely bound stony thing, but probably having an ice composition is reasonable still. Now, the greater picture, though, is even more important, I think, than he alluded to here. There's a lot of these things out there, okay, really a lot. And it's now known that they really do hit every once in a while. And in particular, the Cretaceous-Tertiary extinction 65 million years ago, in which two-thirds of all living species died, most notable the dinosaurs. It was almost certainly caused by an impact off the coast of the Yucatan Peninsula at a place called Chicxulub, of a comet or an asteroid about 10 kilometers in diameter, something like 6 miles. Something like that and bigger can produce such a cloud of material in the atmosphere that it pretty much destroys the food chain throughout the Earth, because it kills the plants, because it blocks the sunlight, and you know, and then the herbivores die, and then the carnivores die, and everything pretty much collapses. Of course, if you're at ground zero, then your death is really quite painless and sudden, right? Because this thing just kind of hits you. And ground zero is much, much bigger than just, you know, 10 kilometers. A crater 10 times as big typically forms, and the region 100 times as big surrounding the impact gets littered with debris and stuff. So So ground zero is actually a pretty big area, but throughout Earth, conditions are terrible, and you can get these mass extinctions. Now, the 10-kilometer-sized objects in our own solar system that are in the asteroid belt are basically known. There's only about, there's not that many of them, and those that have trajectories that can collide with the Earth are basically known. 1 kilometer and above, however, is civilization changing. It won't wipe out all humans, probably, but it'll definitely change civilization. And so far, only about 90% of those have been found. That's pretty good, okay? But we want to find all of them. The ones that are 100 meters and above would cause a lot of damage, especially if they were to land on a city, and there's scads of them. And at most, a few percent are known. So the smaller the size, the more of these things there are, and the smaller the percentage that's known, okay? So astronomers are scouring the skies trying to find these things, because if we find them many decades before they hit, then we can send something up there and gently deflect them. And, you know, a tiny deflection is all you need if you do it many tens of years in advance, because by the time it gets to the Earth, it will have made, you know, a fairly big deviation from its original path. If it's right about to hit you, you've got to deflect it by at least 90 degrees, and then it'll hit someone else. So you really have to deflect it kind of by more than 90 degrees, all right? And that's hard to do. So the key is finding them early. And so astronomers are scanning the skies to do this. And quite recently, a private space-based mission was announced, the Sentinel spacecraft, that's being built, well, it's conceived by the so-called B612 Foundation. And they're interested in putting a satellite in orbit closer to the sun than the Earth is, sort of between the orbits of Venus and the Earth. And it'll look outward using infrared cameras that'll be able to find small guys that don't reflect much sunlight, but they're relatively near the sun. They're kind of near Earth and Mars and those kinds of things. And so they're warm and they'll glow and they emit infrared light. And their goal is to find 90% of all the objects that are bigger than 140 meters in diameter, okay? And these are things that would cause a lot of problems if they were to hit on Earth. And even as Sagan says, you know, if one of these things were to hit Moscow or New York, you know, without thinking about it, we might just assume that the other country has, you know, fired off a nuclear weapon and, you know, you push the red button and then that's it, you know. So his scenario is not completely crazy, you know, it could still happen. So the goal is to find most of these things. And I encourage you to look up this Sentinel thing and contribute if you wish. They're relying on public funds. There are other studies of this sort as well. And so hopefully, within the next decade or two, we'll have a reasonably complete inventory of things that are bigger than 100 or 140 meters in diameter. Now, the ones that are 10 meters in diameter, that wouldn't be much fun either if they hit your house and stuff, or even your neighborhood. But, you know, at some point, these things become too small to find and track. So those are the asteroids. Then there's the threat of comets, okay, which was his issue here. The comets come from out in deep space, from the Kuiper belt and a bigger thing called the scattered disk and an even bigger thing called the Oort cloud. And the problem with comets is that some passing star or gravitational perturbation from Neptune or something nudges the trajectory of one of these things that's way out there, unbeknownst to us, sends it toward the sun, and it only starts becoming visible typically a few months or even a few weeks, in rare cases a year before it gets close to the Earth. And so we probably aren't going to be able to do anything about those, because we'll only have a few months, at most 1 year warning for the big ones, a few weeks warning, a few days maybe for the small ones. So I don't know what we're going to do about the comets. Fortunately, there are far fewer of them than there are asteroids on Earth-crossing orbits. And in the spirit of doing something for humanity, let's at least catalog the asteroids whose trajectories come near Earth. And so I very much favor this. As I say in many of my talks, and as I tell my students, and I'm not sure why they vote me the best professor once I tell them this, you know, we're all going to get destroyed at some point if we don't do something about this. It's really not a question of if, it's a question of when. And it's also, I guess, a question of whether Homo sapiens are still around when it happens. But, you know, over the scale of millions of years, tens of millions of years, something like this is going to happen. Probably not next Tuesday, but it could be next Tuesday. You know, I'm not sure. Maybe the day before the elections. So, you know, someday we hope astronomers will save humanity by finding these things, and then clever engineers and others will send out spacecraft that will bump into the thing. You only need to bump it a little bit. You don't need to blow it up like in all the movies. Indeed, if you just blow it up without changing the trajectory, then you have a whole shower of these things falling on you, right? might be better to just have one, okay? So you just have to nudge it. You just have to whack into it or explode a bomb next to it or you know, attach a tugboat to it that will gravitationally, you know, just park a satellite close to it and let the gravitational tug of the satellite, acting over many decades, gently pull it a little bit out of a collision course trajectory. So anyway, this is big time stuff now, and the government is sufficiently worried about this that they've committed funds to astronomers who are scanning the skies for these things. But
a speed is simply how much space you cover in a given time, as any kid on a motor scooter knows. Since near the velocity of light, we cannot simply add speeds. The familiar notions of absolute space and absolute time, independent of your relative motion, must give way. That's why, as Einstein showed, funny things have to happen close to the speed of light. There are conventional perspectives of space and time strangely change. Your nose is just a little closer to me than your ears. Light reflected off your nose reaches me just an instant in time before your ears. But suppose I had a magic camera so that I could see your nose and your ears at precisely the same instant. With such a camera, you could take some pretty interesting pictures. Paolo says goodbye to his little brother Vincenzo.
No, Vincenzo. Ciao, Paolo.
And rides off. He's now going more than half the speed of light. He's almost catching up with his own light waves. This compresses the light waves in front of him, and his image becomes blue. The shorter wavelength is what makes blue light waves blue. Also, Paolo becomes skinny in the direction of motion. This isn't just some optical illusion. It really happens when you travel near the speed of light. As he roars away, he leaves his own light waves stretched out behind him. Long light waves are red. We say that his receding image is red-shifted. Now, Paolo leaves for a short tour of the countryside. He experiences something even stranger. Everything he can see is squeezed into a moving window just ahead of him. Blue shifted at the center, red shifted at the edges. To a passerby, Paolo appears blue shifted when approaching, red shifted when receding. But to him, the entire world is both coming and going at nearly the speed of light. Roadside houses and trees that he's already gone past still appear to him at the edge of his forward field of view, but distorted and red shifted. When he slows down, everything again looks normal. Only very close to the speed of light does the visible world get squeezed into a kind of tunnel. You would really see these distortions if you could travel near the speed of light. Someday, perhaps, interstellar navigators will take their bearings on stars behind them, whose images have all crowded together on the forward view screen. The most bizarre aspect of traveling near the speed of light is that time slows down. All clocks, mechanical and biological, tick more slowly near the speed of light. But stationary clocks tick at their usual rate. If we travel close to light speed, we age more slowly than those we left behind. Paolo's watch and his internal sense of time show that he's been gone from his friends for only a few minutes. But from their point of view, he has been away for many decades. His friends have grown up, moved on, and died. And his younger brother has been patiently waiting for him all this time. The two brothers experience the paradox of time dilation. They've encountered Einstein's special relativity.
No chance.
This was just a thought experiment, but atomic particles traveling near the speed of light do decay more slowly than stationary particles. As strange and counterintuitive as it seems, time dilation is a law of nature.
All right, well, that's pretty cool, huh? I heard some people saying hard to believe, and it is hard to believe, but the effects of special relativity have been verified quantitatively, you know, thousands and thousands of times, okay? This appears to be reality, that space and time change their shapes, in a sense, based on the relative motion between different reference frames. We use this fact all the time in giant, you know, colliders, like the Large Hadron Collider and other such things, and indeed, there are some things that wouldn't even work correctly if you didn't take this into account. And let me discuss the global positioning system, GPS, okay? Some people say, well, you know, special relativity, not even to mention general relativity, which is Einstein's theory of gravity, you know, relate to black holes and galaxies and things like that, but surely they don't have any relevance to real life here. But they do, because consider GPS. It turns out there are two effects. Let me first just briefly describe how it works. There's a system of satellites up there, that each of which orbits twice per Earth day, per Earth 24-hour period. So they're going at like 14,000 kilometers per hour. That's their speed. Okay, and from any given point on Earth, you always see at least four of these things, and more typically five or six. Okay. And they're sending out radio signals that travel at the speed of light, and they have a time stamp on them, okay? And they have atomic clocks up there, so they know the time precisely. And then your little unit in your car receives these signals, and it notes the time at which it receives the signal from a given satellite, and it knows the time at which that signal was sent, because the radio wave has a time stamp in it. So it calculates a time difference, okay? And distance is speed, the speed of light times time. So from that, you determine the distance to satellite X over there. This is what your little unit is doing. And it determines the distance to at least three or four other satellites, okay? And it turns out you can solve uniquely for where you are on Earth, knowing the distances to at least four other satellites at the same time, okay? So this is what's happening, all right? Well, this technique only works if you know the time at which each signal was emitted and the time at which it was received. If that time difference is not accurately known, then the speed of light times that time difference will give you an inaccurate distance, okay? And even a wrong distance if the clocks are not synchronized. Well, it turns out there are two effects, a special relativistic effect and a general relativistic effect. I said that the satellites are moving with a speed of 14,000 kilometers per hour. According to special relativity, this time dilation effect that Sagan was talking about, this actually means that the clocks up there are running more slowly, as seen by us. It's the what? It's my clock.
Yeah, you're right. Thank you.
We were talking about clocks, and there it was. But funny how it only kicks in about halfway through. Probably I should shorten what I'm saying. Anyway, there's a special relativistic effect in that the clocks up there, as seen by us, compared to clocks down here, are running slightly more slowly at a rate of about, I guess it's 7 microseconds per day more slowly. And that doesn't sound like a lot, but it is. There's another effect, and that is that these satellites are way up there. There are several Earth radii from the surface of the Earth. They're in what's called mid-Earth orbit. They're not the low Earth orbit satellites like the International Space Station and the Hubble Space Telescope, nor are they the geostationary orbits that go around at the same rate at which the Earth turns. So they're sort of mid-Earth orbits in order to complete an orbit in half a day. And gravity up there is weaker than here. And though Sagan didn't talk about it in this part of the series, he probably talked about it when he discussed black holes, time runs at different rates in gravitational fields that are of different strength. So if we're in a stronger gravitational field closer to the center of the Earth than the satellites are. And so we see these satellite clocks running more rapidly compared to ours because they're in a weaker gravitational field. And that effect is 45 microseconds per day. Okay, so it's actually bigger. It's 6.5 times bigger than the special relativistic effect. Well, 45 microseconds per day faster minus 7 microseconds per day slower is a total of 38 microseconds per day faster. That's the rate at which the clocks up there run compared to the ones here. And so if you didn't take that into account, you would have progressively less and less synchronized clocks. I mean, they might start out synchronized, but they would become more and more unsynchronized as time goes on. And you might think, well, 38 microseconds, that's 38 millionths of a second. You know, who cares? You know, your Timex isn't that good, maybe, or maybe it is, I'm not sure. But anyway, it turns out to be a big deal, because it turns out that light travels about a foot per nanosecond, a foot per billionth of a second, okay? So that's 1,000 feet per millionth of a second. That's 5,000 feet, roughly a mile, for every 5 millionths of a second. So 38 microseconds is 7.5 times bigger than that. So that's like being off by 7.5 miles, if you see what I mean, right? Yeah, these are big differences. I mean, if you're off by 38 microseconds, you will miscalculate a distance by 7.5 miles, all right? And that's the first day. The second day, it'll do another 7.5 miles, then more and more and more. So it's a compounding thing. It's like having a clock that runs slowly by 1 minute per day. After the first day, you might not notice it, but after a few months, you'll notice that the clock is beginning to give you a very erroneous time. So if the physicists and engineers who designed GPS system had not taken special and general relativity into account, we wouldn't have a working GPS. And this was initially developed for the military and by the military, but it's now in all kinds of commercial applications. And, you know, you use it all the time when you're, you know, driving around in your car and stuff. Many cars now have a GPS unit. And so it's really very important. So relativity plays a role even in our daily lives. And it's really weird and it's really fantastic, but many experiments seem to have verified its predictions. So to that degree, scientists consider it true, using the word true as in the sense that this provides a good working quantitative model that explains things that we've seen and makes predictions regarding things that we haven't seen yet, and then experiments are done that verify those predictions. That we then consider to be a true theory, which might not be fully, completely true, but, you know, we end up modifying it later on. But at least it's the best working model that we have. Special and general relativity right now are the best working model that we have, at least on the macro scale, and then quantum mechanics is the best working model that we have on the micro scale. Okay? All right. So the next episode, or do we want to do a Q&A?
Let's answer some questions.
All right, let's answer some questions. Let me answer, just a second.
Let me answer a question from my son.
Not that he's here, but I'm picking him up at 5:30 tomorrow morning, and I just want him to know that. So let me just say yes. Okay. Okay, good. And then cut me off when we need to move on with the new episodes.
I will, and I want to encourage people, if at any time, when Professor Filippenko's not speaking, perhaps at any time,
just Alex, pick it up is fine.
And get some more grapes and cheese. Please help and make donations to Wonderfest. Please do so. You're welcome to come on now.
So back to the age of the universe. So kind of two compound questions. The first is, how much time do we have left? And of that, how much time will the universe keep producing planets that might produce
life?
Yeah.
So how much time do we have left? Lots of time if the current acceleration of the universe continues. I mean, if it continues, then the universe will live infinitely long, expanding progressively faster with time. But useful time is a different question, okay? So the useful time around our sun, okay, is pretty limited. Our sun will start becoming a red giant in 5 billion years, and will become a white dwarf in 7 billion years. But even sooner than that, in about 1 billion years, it will have become sufficiently bright, it's very gradually growing brighter, that most calculations suggest that the oceans will have evaporated away by then. So we need to do something well before 1 billion years are up. We need to move to, you know, another planet, but even that's only a temporary thing because, you know, our sun's going to be changing and stuff. So we want to move to another, you know, planetary system. And that's going to be tough to do based on today's technology. But hey, we've got a couple hundred million years in which to solve that problem. I think there's going to be other things we need to deal with before that. If we do move, if we just hop from one nice star to another that's in the middle of its life, then we've got lots of time, even trillions of years. But eventually all stars will die out. And some of them explode and produce, you know, chemically enriched debris from which new stars and planets can form. But most stars do not explode, and so with every generation of star formation, more and more of the gas gets permanently locked up in stars, leaving less and less available for the formation of new stars, planets, and life. So eventually star formation is effectively going to end in our galaxy. It's already 1/10 the rate that it used to be a few billion years ago. Okay, so it's already ramping down. And so eventually new stars will stop forming, and then those stars will die, and then, you know, that'll be it. But now we're looking at, you know, kind of like tens of trillions of years into the future. So I wouldn't worry about it too much. Next question.
Right there. Hi. I'm wondering, in the cosmic calendar episode, where Sagan is talking about the Big Bang, in 1980, could he have talked about inflation?
In 1980, could he have talked about inflation? Very good question. Alan Guth and Andre Linde, which each of whom just won $3 million. Did you hear about this Russian guy, Yuri Milnor or something like that, who decided that, you know, science is great, physics is great, and too few people get recognized for it. So he gave $3 million prizes to 9 theoretical physicists like a couple of days ago. And he's going to do this with, I'm not sure if it's always going to be 9, you know, or whether it's always going to be theoretical physics, but he's going to do this every year. When I say, great, you know, if you make a lot of money off of the internet, you know, Google and Facebook, which is what he did, you know, give it to scientists. I'm a scientist. Anyway, so, okay, not for me, for funding my research, okay? And by the way, there are no strings attached as far as I can see with these prizes. But so Linde and Guth were the ones who originated the concept of inflation in 1979, 1980, 1981. So it was just beginning to be talked about, and initially most of us didn't even take it very seriously. And Guth himself, in his published article, says that this is an interesting idea, but he just thought of a fatal, or a potentially fatal flaw, which other physicists then solved. But all I'm trying to say is that in 1980, you know, when I first heard about it, or 81, maybe I only heard about it in 82, you know, we were all just beginning to hear about it, and moreover, it wasn't being taken very seriously. Now there's considerable evidence for that hypothesis, so I wouldn't be surprised if Sagan had not heard it, or if he had heard of it, probably didn't take it very seriously. Few of us did.
Yeah. Back here.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, a question about that last clip with Paolo and Vincenzo.
Yeah.
So from Paolo's perspective, Vincenzo's moving around.
That's right.
At the speed of, close to the speed of light.
The twin paradox.
Yeah, but why is it that Vincenzo is the one that has to age?
Right.
Why can't Paolo?
So in my class I would use the Socratic method, but we're limited in time here, so let me just answer it.
Good.
Initially it looks like the two twins are exactly, you know, the same. In other words, from one person's, I forgot which one stayed on Earth, but one twin sees the other one go away, you know, and come back, and then the other one says, well, you know, I don't necessarily know that I'm moving, you know, right, if he doesn't pay attention to his little motorbike and stuff, if he's just in a dark room, then looking through a window, he might think that his twin is the one who's moving, okay? And so he would see that the other guy's time going more slowly, and he would be aging at the normal rate. So there's this twin paradox. Why is one of them definitely older and the other one definitely not have aged very much when they come back? The resolution comes from the fact that one of them had to turn around, and that's an acceleration. An acceleration is an absolutely measurable quantity. In other words, if we're moving at constant speed, like in a non-bumpy airplane ride, you actually can't tell you're moving. But if the plane accelerates or hits pockets of air and stuff like that, then you really know you're in the airplane and it's not just that you're hovering up here and the Earth is whipping by, okay? So accelerations are an absolute. And indeed, in general relativity, accelerations are equivalent to gravity. And I just told you that in different gravitational fields, time runs at different rates. So the one who made the trip is the one that accelerated, in a sense, is the one who went through a different gravitational field, and his or her clocks really are the ones that slowed down relative to the twin that stayed at home. So that's how you break the symmetry. One of them turned around. Great question. Okay, far corner there. Yes.
Yeah. I'll be getting back to the Hubble constant again. Back in 1980, cosmologists were divided into two warring camps. Right? I mean, half of them were saying H equals 50, and the other half said H equals 100.
That's right.
I'm just wondering, I mean, can you just bring me up to date? Why did it bifurcate so cleanly? Why did nobody ever publish a paper saying H equals 75 or H equals 71? I mean, they'd be famous now.
People did, yeah. People did, those who wanted to please everyone, you know. But in a sense, in the newspapers, the reporters highlighted this 50 versus 100 to really make a point that cosmologists had this huge problem on their hands, that the uncertainties were a factor of two, which is why I claimed a plus or minus 50% uncertainty in some of my opening remarks. That's where it comes from, 50 or 100. And so 75, if you're right in the middle there, you know, it's plus or minus 25, which is about a third. And some people were even saying that the Hubble constant might be 30, and some others were saying 120. So if you look at the most extreme range, you get this 50% range that I mentioned. But most newspaper articles fixated on 50 and 100 because that was sort of, those were representative values of the two camps. The other reason is that there were two very famous figures representing those camps. Alan Sandage at the Carnegie Observatories in Pasadena was firmly in the 50 camp. And Gerard de Vaucouleurs, an astronomer at the University of Texas at Austin, was a big-time guy, and he argued vociferously for 100. And they were two great spokespersons of modern cosmology back then, and they were in the 50 and 100 camp. And so that's what the press tended to emphasize as well. Okay, but these were representatives of the extremes, although by no means the extreme extremes. I mean, Joe Silk, a colleague of mine at Berkeley, wrote a paper arguing that the Hubble constant might be close to 30 kilometers per second per megaparsec. Yeah.
Let's take two more questions up front here and then a quick break.
I heard somewhere that eventually, as the universe keeps expanding, we will be alone in the sky. We won't be able to see any other stars. Everything will be so far apart.
Yeah.
I mean, I doubt we're going to last that long.
We probably won't last that long, but it isn't a true statement. Yeah, so we will see stars because they're in our galaxy and they're gravitationally bound to us, with due consideration for the fact that eventually those stars will burn out and then we won't see them. But that's a different reason from the one you're talking about, the expansion reason. Because of the accelerating expansion, what's going to happen is that other galaxies, and more correctly, other galaxies outside our local group, which consists of us, Andromeda, and a whole bunch of little dwarf galaxies, we're all going to kind of merge together and become one big super galaxy. And so there will be lots and lots of stars. But outside this local group, which will have turned into one plus maybe a few galaxies, other clusters will be moving away from us faster and faster because of this acceleration, and eventually will be too faint to see. There will always be one last photon which is on its way and that we could detect. So people who say that they go beyond the distance, well, sometimes people glibly say that they move away from us so fast that the photons can't reach us. And that's basically true, but there's a technicality in the sense that if photons are continuously being emitted by a galaxy, there's always another photon that was emitted just before this thing reached the speed of light barrier, okay? And because of the time dilation effect, it takes an infinite amount of time to reach us. And the ones that were emitted right before us take a little bit less than an infinite amount of time to reach us. So there will always be photons, but they will be so faint that you will effectively lose sight of the galaxies as the universe expands in eternity. And by the way, Woody Allen said, eternity is a very long time, especially near the end, okay? So yes, the other clusters of galaxies will fade from view. Front center here, yes.
Mm-hmm. I was wondering, how confident are we that dark energy actually exists as opposed to just a misunderstanding of what gravity or
gravity works? Well, that's right. So I'm glad you guys have a microphone so I don't have to repeat all the questions. But what we have measured is an acceleration of the expansion of the universe. And that is almost unanimously, not unanimously, but almost unanimously believed throughout the world by physicists and astronomers now, because aside from our own measurements, which we published 14 years ago, there's now been independent techniques that have given the same result. And so these independent techniques presumably have different possible errors associated with them. They're all giving the same result, which is either a very cruel trick on us, and it's wrong, right, or it's right. And most of us think it's right. The interpretation is much, much more ambiguous. And by the way, the Nobel Prize was given for the discovery of the acceleration, not the interpretation. The most common interpretation is that the universe is filled with this dark energy of unknown origin, often considered the number one observationally motivated unsolved problem in all of physics. Okay, what is the nature and origin of the dark energy? So most physicists think there's this dark energy, but there could also be a problem with Einstein's general theory of relativity on big distances. That could be leading to this acceleration. Fewer physicists think that right now, but quite a number think that, you know, relativity might be wrong, but more think that dark energy is what's filling the universe. Maybe there's a completely separate, different explanation, and, you know, I sometimes joke that I wake up at 3 a.m. screaming that dark matter and dark energy are the 21st century counterpart of the Ptolemaic epicycles. The epicycles worked remarkably well, especially if you put epicycles on top of epicycles. You could reproduce the observed positions of the planets with arbitrary accuracy. Essentially, for those of you who know, Ptolemaic epicycles were one way, actually, without Ptolemy realizing it, he was developing a branch of mathematics called Fourier analysis. Any periodic function, regardless of its shape, can be represented by the sum of a whole bunch of sines and cosines having different amplitudes and different periods. Okay, and if you add epicycles on top of epicycles, that's what you're doing. So he could explain the positions of the planets with arbitrary accuracy, but with a fundamentally incorrect model, right? And that wasn't his fault, right? He was actually quite brilliant to come up with what he did back then. But I worry that dark energy and maybe even, well, I worry that dark energy specifically is a modern day epicycle, a failure of Einstein's general relativity, would not be as much of an epicycle, because what we're saying is this very beautiful theory that all of us believe in is wrong, and that's building a new revolution in a sense, you know. Whereas thinking of dark energy is just adding, some people think, a fudge factor. So maybe it's a fudge factor. Or maybe there's some completely different explanation not having to do with general relativity or dark energy that I haven't thought of yet. If I think of it, maybe I'll publish it.
Now, imagine a universe just like Flatland, truly two-dimensional, and entirely flat in every direction. But with one exception. Unbeknownst to the inhabitants, their two-dimensional universe is curved into a third physical dimension, maybe into a sphere, but at any rate, into something entirely outside their experience. Locally, their universe still looks flat enough, but if one of them, much smaller and flatter than me, takes a very long walk along what seems to be a straight line, he would uncover a great mystery. Suppose he marked his starting point here and set off to explore his universe. He never turns around and he never reaches an edge. He doesn't know that his apparently flat universe is actually curved into an enormous sphere. He doesn't sense that he's walking around a globe. Why should his space be curved? Because there's so much matter in this universe that it gravitationally warps space, closing it back on itself into a sphere. but our Flatlander doesn't know this. After a long while, you'll find he somehow returns to his starting point. There must be a third dimension.
Our Flatlander couldn't imagine a third dimension, but he could sure deduce it. Now, increase all the dimensions in this story by one, and you have something like the situation which many cosmologists think may actually apply to us. We are three-dimensional creatures trapped in three dimensions. We imagine our universe to be flat in three dimensions, but maybe it's curved into a fourth. We can talk about a fourth physical dimension, but we can't experience it. No one can point to the fourth dimension. I mean, there's left, right, and there's forward, back, there's up, down, and some other direction simultaneously at right angles to those familiar three dimensions.
Now, imagine this universe is expanding. If we blow it up like a four-dimensional balloon, what happens? An astronomer in a given galaxy thinks all the other galaxies are running away from him. The more distant the galaxy, the faster it seems to be moving. This is just what Humason and Hubble found. On the surface of this curved universe, there is no boundary or center. The universe can be both finite and unbounded.
The redshift of the distant galaxies seemed to imply to Humason's contemporaries that we were at the center of an expanding universe, that our place in space was somehow privileged. But if the universe is expanding, whether or not it's curved into a fourth dimension, observers on every galaxy will see precisely the same thing. All the galaxies rushing away from them as if they had made some dreadful intergalactic social blunder. If there's enough matter to close the universe gravitationally, then it's wrapped in on itself like a sphere. If there isn't enough matter to close the cosmos, then our universe has an open shape extending forever in all directions. This saddle universe is only one of an infinite number of possible kinds of open universes. Unlike such closed universes as the sphere, open universes have in them an infinite amount of space.
If our universe is in fact closed off, then nothing can get out, not matter, not light. We would then be living inside a black hole. There is one possible way out, though, a hypothetical tunnel or wormhole through the next higher dimension, a place sucking in matter and light. Can we find such a wormhole? Could we survive the trip? We might emerge in some other place and time, perhaps in another universe, or perhaps somewhere else in our own.
If you want to know what it's like inside a black hole, look around. But we don't yet know whether the universe is open or closed. More than that, there are a few astronomers who doubt that the redshift of distant galaxies is due to the Doppler effect, who are skeptical about the expanding universe and the Big Bang. Perhaps our descendants will regard our present ignorance with as much sympathy as we feel to the ancients for not knowing whether the Earth went around the Sun. Without doubt, the universe has been expanding since the Big Bang, but it is by no means clear that it will continue to expand forever. If there is less than a certain amount of matter in the universe, then the mutual gravitation of the receding galaxies will be insufficient to stop the expansion, and the universe will run away forever. But if there is more matter than we can see, hidden away in black holes, say, or in hot but invisible gas between the galaxies, then the universe holds together and partakes of a very Indian succession of cycles, expansion followed by contraction, cosmos upon cosmos, universes without end. If we live in such an oscillating universe, then the Big Bang is not the creation of the cosmos, but merely the end of the previous cycle, the destruction of the last incarnation of the cosmos. Neither of these modern cosmologies may be altogether to our liking. In one cosmology, the universe is created somehow from nothing 15 to 20 billion years ago and expands forever, the galaxies mutually receding until the last one disappears over our cosmic horizon. Then the galactic astronomers are out of business. The stars cool and die, matter itself decays, and the universe becomes a thin, cold haze of elementary particles. In the other, the oscillating universe, the cosmos has no beginning and no end, and we are in the midst of an infinite cycle of cosmic deaths and rebirths, with no information trickling through the cusps of the oscillation. Nothing of the galaxies, stars, planets, life forms, civilizations evolved in the previous incarnation of the universe trickles through the cusp, flitters past the Big Bang to be known in our universe. The death of the universe in either cosmology may seem a little depressing, but we may take some solace in the timescales involved. These events will take tens of billions of years or more. Human beings, or our descendants, whoever they might be, can do a great deal of good in tens of billions of years before the cosmos dies.
The oscillating universe is philosophically and aesthetically appealing. It's mentioned in Buddhist cosmology and lots of cultures, actually. But I wanted to say that even if a big crunch, that is the reverse of a big bang, a collapse were to occur, we have no idea whether a new universe will be reborn out of that. And he couldn't really say it back in 1980. The problem is we don't have a quantum theory of gravity. We don't have a fully self-consistent theory of physics when a large amount of matter is compressed into a very small volume. So you need to use Einstein's general theory of relativity because it's a large amount of matter, and you have to use quantum physics because it's a small volume, the singularity. So the idea that after a big crunch you get a rebirth is absolutely pure speculation. It could happen, but we have nothing in physics that says that it would necessarily happen. So a big crunch, as far as we're concerned right now, just ends with a big crunch, and it may or may not give a rebirth. And at least in these segments, he gave no indication of any uncertainty about what would happen if there were a big crunch, right? He says, we don't know whether it's going to be a big crunch or not. The universe could expand forever, or it could recollapse. But he said, if it recollapses, then it'll be reborn. I don't know. No one knows. And they didn't know in 1980. So that's interesting. I'm surprised, actually, that he did not indicate some degree of uncertainty and did not indicate that that was speculation. Going a little bit back, redshift skeptics, very few of them now. The universe is expanding. The redshifts are entirely consistent with an expansion. There's so much evidence, you know, the more highly redshifted galaxies appear smaller in the sky, they're fainter, they appear different from today's galaxies because we're looking back in time, they're far away, and they've evolved. We see big nearby galaxies at low redshift gravitationally lensing background galaxies which have higher redshifts. When we take spectra of quasars, very bright beacons, we can see that nearby quasars, their spectra show through absorption lines the presence of a few intergalactic clouds of gas, and higher redshift quasars have many, many more clouds between us and them. No surprise, because they're farther away. They're at higher redshift. The main opponents of the redshift interpretation are basically gradually dying off is sort of the true way of putting it. I mean, Jeff Burbage at UC San Diego, I admire him a lot. He did a lot of great astrophysics in his life, but he just refused, I think, to consider the overwhelming evidence at this stage, and he died a few years ago. It's too bad, but you know, it's the way it goes for all of us. You know, Chip Arp still lives. He's one of the main people who raised the controversy decades ago while working at Palomar Observatory. He found interesting cases of quasars right next to galaxies in the sky, which could be that, well, there's a nearby galaxy and a distant quasar. They're just along the same line of sight. That in and of itself is not that interesting, but he found what he thought to be connections of luminous material between the galaxies and the quasar, suggesting that they are somehow related to one another. And those connections of luminous material have been shown either to be optical illusions or random galaxies that happen to be projected between the quasar and that galaxy and of no physical connection. He lives in Germany, in Munich, I think, and still claims that redshifts are not cosmological, and he's quite old now, and there are very few others like him, and basically, yeah. I mean, it's sometimes said that old discredited ideas in science never completely go away until their proponents die, because it's very hard to change the minds of people who have made up their minds and have built careers based on stuff. And even with the best of us, right, even with Einstein and others, it's difficult to change as you get older, okay? And for theoretical physicists and astrophysicists and stuff, this is actually quite evident. Most theoretical physicists do most of their greatest work when they're actually quite young. They know a lot because they've learned it, but they're not so set in their ways yet that they're unable to conceive of new, completely different, foundationally different ideas. And so Einstein did his greatest work when he was young. Feynman, many others, did their greatest work when they were young. We like to say that observational astronomers and experimental physicists only get better with age, like a fine wine, you see, because we learn better and better techniques and stuff. But in theoretical work, people are people, and they tend to get set in their ways. Okay, the wormhole, going into a wormhole and ending up in some other universe. That's an interesting possibility based on the mathematics of what we call idealized black holes and idealized wormholes. By that I mean an idealized black hole and wormhole is one that existed with the birth of the universe. In other words, it was there to begin with. There was this tunnel through space connecting either different parts of our universe through a shortcut, whereas the long way around would be much, much longer, or maybe even connecting up other universes with ours. It's a theoretical possibility when you look at the simplest, most idealized equations of general relativity. And that's what he was really talking about there. Unfortunately, we've learned since that time that those idealized equations become very messy in real life. So if you consider a black hole that formed from the actual collapse of a massive star, we now understand that the equations describing that black hole are much more complex, and the wormhole squeezes shut and doesn't allow anything to pass, basically because of the gravity that's there. And even if you found a pristine one, if you tried to jump into it, your presence would squeeze it shut. And if not that, then there's a whole bunch of radiation that tends to pile up inside a rotating black hole, and you get what's called this mass inflation instability, which I don't completely understand, but there's a whole bunch of radiation in the end that would sort of totally fry you, okay? And so that wouldn't be a good death either. That wouldn't be a good way to pass into a different part of our universe either, even if the wormhole still technically is there. You get vaporized by all this radiation flying around inside black holes, right? Because anything that went into the black hole is still there, and so there's all this radiation that completely fries you. So we actually don't think that wormholes will get you from here to there. Interestingly, you know, Sagan wrote his novel Contact, which was then turned into a movie based on this idea, and Ellie Arroway jumps into a black hole that goes off somewhere to Vega and then comes back. And he tried to make it as realistic as possible. He asked a general relativist, Kip Thorne, who's at Caltech, still at Caltech. He said, "Kip, I'd like to make this as realistic as possible, so can you find a way to make the traversal of a wormhole more realistic?" And Kip and his students and postdocs dreamed up a way of doing so. They showed that if you had what they called exotic matter, which basically had an anti-gravitating effect, not dark energy, because that's kind of spread uniformly everywhere, but stuff that you could collect and harness, and if you could stick it inside a black hole, or maybe form a ring around it, I'm not sure, you could conceivably hold the throat open. And so Sagan said, great, so there is maybe a way of holding it open. And so he used the idea. The trouble is, we haven't found any such exotic matter that has an anti-gravitating effect, and is sort of replacing one difficulty with another. If there were exotic matter, however, maybe you could hold the throat of a wormhole open, but we don't know of any such stuff. I'm going backwards now. He said that closed universes, those that have a sufficiently high density of stuff, are necessarily the ones that recollapse. And at that time, it was thought to be true, and indeed, for decades, this is what I taught in my class. And I still teach that a dense universe recollapses, but I don't include the word necessarily. And here's the reason. If the total matter density plus dark energy density, and dark energy, remember, is repulsive, exceeds the critical value for recollapse, then the universe will actually expand forever, because it's only when you have gravitationally attractive material whose density exceeds this critical value that you necessarily get a recollapse. But if a good fraction of the density of stuff in the universe is this repulsive dark energy, which he couldn't have known about, then it turns out the closed universe, the one that looks like a balloon, a hypersphere, doesn't necessarily recollapse, it can expand forever. So the one-to-one correspondence between geometry and fate has been messed up by this dark energy. It used to be that the geometry of the universe went hand-in-hand with the fate. The hypersspheres, the closed universes, necessarily recollapsed. The infinite open universes, the ones that look like horses settle, the hyperbolic universes, necessarily expanded forever. That is no longer true. The hyperbolic ones, we think, yes, expand forever, but the closed ones could expand forever as well if much of their material is this repulsive dark energy. And he couldn't have known that, so that's a new thing. How to tell whether a universe is open or closed? That is, does it have this saddle-shaped geometry or a sphere? He mentioned the possibility of walking in a straight line, and in a closed universe you end up back where you started. That's true of my balloon, wherever my balloon went, that I put in my pocket. No, here it is. If you walk in one direction, you'll come back to the point from which you started. He didn't mention another test, which I think he was probably aware of, but just didn't have time. And that is to draw gigantic triangles, okay? Draw big, big triangles. If you do that on a flat sheet of paper, you will find that if you've drawn a legal triangle, you haven't messed it up somehow, the sum of the interior angles will always equal 180 degrees. That's a problem of Euclidean geometry, the geometry you learned in 10th grade or something. An equilateral triangle has three 60-degree angles, right? So 3 times 60 is 180. A right triangle has a 90 and 245, so that's 180. But draw any triangle and it'll always be 180, not just these special ones, okay? So that's a consequence of Euclidean geometry, and that's what we call flat space. We don't necessarily mean that the universe is a flat sheet of paper. Obviously, it goes in the up-down direction as well. But what we're saying is, no matter which direction you drew this gigantic triangle, you would find that it satisfies this consequence of Euclidean geometry, that the sum of the interior angles is 180 degrees. On a sphere, it's always greater than 180 degrees. And let me give you an example. Suppose this is the North Pole and here's the equator, and I draw two lines of longitude down to the equator, and then I connect them up along the equator. These two angles, by construction, are both 90 degrees because lines of longitude are perpendicular to lines of latitude. Okay, so these two lines of longitude come down to the equator and form two angles, each 90 degrees. There's 180 already, right? And then there's the angle between them. Right, call it alpha. So, and that could be anything between, you know, 0 and 180, or even 0 and 360, depending on exactly how you define it. So, but the point is that the sum of the interior angles is greater than 180 degrees. And if they drew sufficiently big triangles, they would figure that out. Okay. Interestingly, the mathematician Gauss, who lived in Germany, tried to directly determine or measure the curvature of the Earth by drawing gigantic triangles over the German countryside. And this is illustrated, I believe, on the old either 10 or 20 Deutsche Mark bill. I don't remember which one. Is it the 10? Does anyone know that? Gauss is there and he's got some triangles. Unfortunately, you know, Germany has, you know, little hills and things, and Bavaria and stuff, you know. So it turns out local curvature dwarfs this effect, you know. But if you could go out in Kansas and stuff and draw big enough triangles, you might see this effect. Although even Kansas, I think the slope of the rock, well, I'm not sure. Anyway, maybe you could do it. But you need a pretty big area on the Earth, you know, because the Earth is pretty big. So to see this effect, you have to draw big triangles. Okay, what about the horse saddle, the hyperbolic geometry? What do you think the sum of the interior angles is of a triangle? Less than 180 degrees. There you go. Okay, so the flat space is the dividing line between negatively curved space, so-called hyperbolic space, and positively curved space, so-called spherical or hyperspherical space. And so what's the answer? Well, we've drawn gigantic triangles. It turns out that by looking at small fluctuations in the density of material far, far back in time, and these are in these cosmic microwave background radiation maps, you know, the different regions have slightly different temperatures and they emit different amounts of radiation and stuff, and you can detect that using today's radio telescopes. We detect a nearly uniform early universe, but at a few parts per 100,000, there are slight temperature irregularities corresponding to slight density irregularities, and these are things that grew gravitationally into galaxies and clusters of galaxies eventually over billions of years, because gravity is the great sculptor of the universe. Anyway, there were tiny fluctuations at early times. And we can calculate how big the typical ones were in meters. Okay, they're much, much bigger than meters, okay? But think of them as a very distant meter stick, okay? We know how big they are. That's relatively theory independent. You don't have to make many assumptions. It's really quite simple. So we know how big the typical fluctuations really are. We measure their angular size in the sky with these radio telescopes. And it turns out, a given physical size like this pen has a smaller and smaller angular size the farther and farther away it is from me. And the relationship between angular size and distance is an inverse proportionality if you live in a flat space. But it turns out to differ a little bit if you live in a curved space. And that leads to triangles that bulge out a little bit more or look like those on a saddle-shaped thing if our universe is significantly curved. Well, we've made these measurements of how big the blobs appear to be, and we know how big they really are, and lo and behold, they satisfy the relationship expected of a Euclidean universe, one which is globally flat. Now, obviously near the sun, it's curved. That's what general relativity is all about, and that's why Earth follows an orbit around the sun, is that locally there's this curvature, and near a black hole, there's a lot of curvature. But average over all that, over billions of years, my goodness, space is flat. So does that mean that the universe really is infinite and just like a flat sheet of paper? Well, we don't really know, because we now think that the observed part of the universe is only a tiny fraction of the whole thing, truly almost infinitesimal. And so just like in Kansas or in Germany, it's hard to draw a big enough triangle. We can't. In the observable part of the universe, there's no triangle big enough for us to right now distinguish between perfectly flat or slightly negatively curved or slightly positively curved. So we just don't know whether we are actually a gigantic sphere or truly perfectly flat, which is unlikely, or a horse's saddle. My guess, this is my preference, is that we are a gigantic sphere, that the universe began either as a quantum fluctuation in some pre-existing hyperspace, or maybe as a quantum fluctuation from a pre-existing universe, and then it grew by this process of inflation that someone already mentioned into a really gigantic thing. And inflation can make universes that are so big that the part we can see is almost irrelevant. Here's an analogy I like to give. The observable part of the universe compared to all that there is might be like a proton in the observable universe. Okay? That's It might be. We don't know. We actually don't know how big the universe is. We estimate through various things that it's at least 80 times the volume that we can see, but you know, the Earth is way more than 80 times the volume of, you know, the, or the area of the state of Kansas, you know. So, and it's hard to do this even in Kansas and Germany. So we just don't know the shape of the universe. Finally, and then I'll open it up for questions, he showed an expanding sphere with galaxies on it. Did anyone notice something that was wrong? Someone said it. Something about the galaxies, yes. He had the galaxies expanding. He drew dots, basically, on his balloon. Tisk, tisk. The galaxies don't expand. The galaxies are gravitationally bound. They are not participating in the expansion of the universe. Neither are you. You're bound by electromagnetic forces, it turns out. Though you're electrically neutral, the molecules inside you have, you know, positive parts and negative parts, and they all kind of hold each other together. Residual electromagnetic forces are what hold you together, and they are way greater than any tendency of space to expand. So you might expand after a big meal, but that's not the universe's fault. That's your fault, okay? So it's better to put stickers. Even stickers are not perfect, because stickers rest on the surface of the balloon. That's in the up dimension. Right? Really, the stickers should be embedded in the balloon, but I haven't found a balloon store that sells those kinds of balloons, at least not cheaply. But I still think that stickers on a balloon is less incorrect than drawing dots on a balloon. Because if you draw dots in the balloon, they expand, and that gives the incorrect impression that galaxies expand, and they do not. So that was an unfortunate error in his show. Okay. How about we open it up for questions? Yeah, okay, yeah. That was the balloon, not me.
Okay, we'll get a couple of questions in. Let me start at this end.
You've mentioned that the galaxies are expanding, but...
The galaxies are not expanding.
I'm sorry, you've mentioned that...
Thank you.
That the space between us
the space
and galaxies
between the galaxies. More correctly, the space between clusters of galaxies.
And that the galaxies themselves will stay intact and
right.
Their bodies will stay intact.
That's right.
But isn't it the case that the mix of dark energy, dark and such has changed over time, and
yeah.
Some things seem to indicate that the amount of dark energy will actually dominate and will actually overcome the gravitational attraction and maybe even the electrostatic attraction.
Right, so here's the thing.
And also, much earlier you said that we would always be able to see stars nearby because our stars will never leave.
Yeah, that's because the galaxies are not expanding. So that part is easy, right? That's consistent with what I just said. The galaxies are not expanding, so we will always be able to see stars in our galaxy, modulo this, you know, this caveat that stars will eventually die.
Even if dark energy dominates.
Yeah, yeah. So, if dark energy dominates, so this is the interesting question. Okay. The dark energy that we measure is consistent. We don't know that that's, you know, that's necessarily so, but it's at least observationally consistent with having an energy density, that is an energy per unit volume, that does not change with time. Okay. So, if the energy density is not enough to expand the galaxies right now, it will never be enough, if it's truly not changing with time. If there's more and more space growing between the clusters of galaxies, then yes, the total amount of dark energy is increasing, and those clusters are going away from us faster and faster, and we will eventually lose sight of them because they'll become too faint to be seen. But the stars in our galaxy, if they're not being pushed apart now, they never will be, if the dark energy remains constant with time. Let's explore the possibilities. Some theories suggest that the dark energy density may be decreasing with time. In that case, if the galaxies aren't being unbound right now, they never will be, obviously. A small minority of theories suggest weird forms of dark energy. They're called phantom energy. Those kinds of dark energy are a kind that increases in density with time. And if it remains repulsive, then indeed, eventually clusters of galaxies will get torn apart, ripped is the word, then galaxies will get ripped apart, then planetary systems will get ripped apart, then planets and humans and the very atoms of which you are made will eventually get ripped apart because atoms have empty space in them, and if the density of the repulsive stuff grows without bound, then atoms will eventually get ripped apart. This is a type of dark energy that is not favored by most theorists. because it has some problems with conservation of energy, whereas normal dark energy, it turns out, does not have problems with conservation of energy. Conservation of energy is thought to be a true law of nature. We don't know for sure that that's the case, but a lot of things would look more less aesthetically pleasing if dark energy could actually grow with time. The data are not inconsistent with it. There could be dark energy that grows in density with time, but it's also, the data are also very consistent with dark energy that stays the same. And of all the various hypotheses for the dark energy, the simplest hypothesis is that it's just a property of space itself that never changes with time. It's called Einstein's cosmological constant. So if the dark energy is the cosmological constant, then we will never get ripped apart. The Big Rip will never happen. But there were some New York Times articles about the Big Rip because it's an exciting possibility, and it has not been completely ruled out. But it's not favored either. Okay.
You're right in the center.
You're right in the center here. Okay.
Question.
Yes.
Can you explain the connection, if any, between the present Hubble expansion of the universe and the inflationary expansion of the early universe?
Right. Can I explain the connection between the present day expansion of the universe and the early inflationary expansion? Right. So the present day expansion, we thought, should be slowing down because the gravity of all galaxies and dark matter pulls on all other galaxies and dark matter. We found that it's accelerating and has been for the past 5 billion years. For the first 9 billion years, it was actually decelerating, and 5 billion years ago, it started accelerating. If this continues, and if the dark energy continues to become a progressively more important component of the total pie, its slice is now 73% and growing with time. If it continues to grow and it continues to be repulsive, then eventually this acceleration, which itself is accelerating, will become a new function, which we call exponentiation. That's a doubling for every unit of time, whatever that unit is. We're not there yet. We might never reach that if it changes sign, but it could reach that. The exponentiation is what we think characterized the universe during its early inflationary epoch. In the first trillionth of a trillionth of a trillionth of a second of the universe's existence, space was dominated by a repulsive-like dark energy. We call it the inflaton to distinguish it from today's dark energy. But it was the dominant stuff of the universe. It made the universe double in size every 10 to the minus 36 or so seconds. 10 to the minus 37, minus 35. People quibble. You can ask Alan Guth. You can tell him you'll pay him 10 bucks for the answer and he won't care anymore because he now has 3 million. But anyway, that exponentiation that characterized inflation is a much more radical form of acceleration than what we are currently experiencing. But we might be entering a new inflationary epoch if this dark energy continues to dominate more and more and more and does not change sign, okay?
Last official question of the night, right up front.
The last comments that you made before Q&A started talked about the size, and I have this naive impression that the size of the universe can be measured by the amount of time that it's been since the Big Bang.
Yeah.
So if it was 13.7 billion years and stuff can't go faster than the speed of light,
right,
isn't the radius of the universe roughly, give or take,
right,
13.7
billion
years?
I like this. You guys are a thinking audience.
And I realize that relativity means that things can fly apart faster than the speed of light, because of the warping of the space. But you say we might only see 1/80th of the total, and yet we have telescopes that go all the way out. We can see back to only 300,000 years or so after the Big Bang.
That's right, 380,000 years, yeah. Okay, so the question basically revolves around how can the universe get bigger than the parts that we can see, okay? If it started from some finite size. It turns out that relativity doesn't prevent and is not inconsistent with an expansion of space faster than the speed of light. It only prevents particles moving through space, through a pre-existing space,
faster than light. That's what E equals MC squared is all about. What happens when particles approach the speed of light is that their effective mass becomes bigger by a factor called gamma, and gamma tends to infinity as the speed approaches the speed of light. And so it would take an infinite amount of energy to accelerate any material particle having a non-zero rest mass up to the speed of light. The only reason photons can go at the speed of light is that they have no rest mass. If you were to put a photon on a table, it would cease to exist. So, relativity prevents particles with non-zero mass from reaching the speed of light. But it does not forbid superluminal expansion. And indeed, during inflation, you have superluminal expansion in spades. Here's what's going on. Suppose I have two ping pong balls, these are galaxies, that are separated from each other by more than 300,000 kilometers, okay? Just by some very big distance, okay? And now I tell space to expand in size. Let's say I synchronize all the clocks and I just tell them that at noon they're gonna each double in size, so each centimeter is gonna turn into two, okay? Well, two galaxies that were originally separated by more than 300,000 kilometers will now, after 1 second, be more than 600,000 kilometers apart. Thus, they will have moved away from each other by more than 300,000 kilometers in 1 second. That's the speed of light, okay? So they will have moved from each other faster than the speed of light. But that's only because of the cumulative effect of every centimeter, no, millimeter, nanometer, doubling in size, okay? It's a very local effect which globally turns into a very big expansion speed. But you can't use that stretching of space to send any particle or any information from one ping pong ball to the other. Indeed, the very fact that space is expanding faster than the speed of light is what prevents any signal, any particle, any material particle from ever getting from this ping pong ball to that one. Because it covers some space, but the remaining space is expanding faster than the speed of light, so that particle can never get there. But during inflation, the universe doubles in size. It goes from like anything you want, a proton, to way bigger than you need with 100 doubling times. You try folding a newspaper, okay? You can do it maybe 7 times, okay, if you're really good at it. 100 doublings is just enormous. 1,000 doublings is almost beyond comprehension, right? 1,000 doublings, that's 2^1,000th power. That's roughly 2^3 to the 300th power, very roughly, okay? 2^3 is roughly 10, so that's 10^300th power. Do you know what kind of a number 10^300th is? Do you know how many particles there are within our observable universe? Photons, protons, you name it, put them all in the bin. How many particles are there? 10^80th. So numbers like 10^100th and 10^300th are so beyond comprehension that you get these truly gargantuan universes, like I said, that can easily be so much bigger than the part we observe that the part we observe is like a proton in the whole thing. So the universe goes whoosh. That happened in a split second. Then the dark energy of back then, the inflaton, turned off for reasons we don't understand. It decayed into something that's gravitationally attractive. Okay, so the acceleration of the apple was the inflation, and then I let go of the apple. That's when inflation turned off, and the stuff of which inflation was made, which is you and I and everyone else, that became gravitationally attractive. Okay, so from that point on, the universe started decelerating like this apple, and it did that for 9 billion years, and then 5 billion years ago, this weird dark energy took over for reasons we don't yet understand, okay? But right after inflation, the universe was gigantic. Stars, light bulbs, only started forming some 200 million years after the Big Bang, okay? And the 380,000 that you were referring to, that's where the cosmic microwave background radiation comes from. That's where the universe just consisted of little tiny density fluctuations of a few parts per 100,000, okay? But stars had not yet formed, okay? But even if stars had formed at that time, at 380,000 years instead of 200 million, they're forming like light bulbs in a pre-expanded universe, kind of like a pre-baked, loaf of bread or a pre-baked pizza. You can bring them home and bake it the rest of the way. So here's this gigantic universe, and then stars start forming. Okay, once a star forms, it starts sending light out. How far will the light get in 1 year? Well, out to a sphere of radius 1 light year. And at this point, let's ignore the additional expansion because it's almost irrelevant. Okay, so in 1 year, the light gets out to 1 light year. Stars within 1 year, or creatures within 1 light year of that star will see it come into existence, you know. Creatures that are 10 light years from it will not yet see it, okay, right? But in 10 years, that light will reach those guys, and in 100 years, it'll reach the others. So the observable universe keeps growing with time. And we're not limited in terms of the size of the universe by the amount of time it has existed and the speed of light, because it grew superluminally by many, 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 many factors during this inflationary stage. And even though we're not inflating right now, we're only accelerating, and actually even in a decelerating universe, parts that are sufficiently far away from each other are in fact still moving away from each other faster than the speed of light, because every little bit of space expanded, and the more space you have, the greater will be the total amount of expansion. But that's a very good question, which is why I tried to answer it at length, because it's the reasonable deduction. What you said was not unreasonable. And the explanation is actually quite subtle.